Testing, testing. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Faculty of Law. I'm very happy to see you here, notwithstanding the strange weather we've been having here. Hot, cold, wet, dry, well, mainly wet. Yeah. Today we are very honored, yeah, to have the Honourable Constance Hunt, Judge of the Court of Appeal of Alberta, Nunavut, and Northwest Territories. Yeah. Fascinating part of Canada, yeah. We're very happy to have her here to speak to us, yeah. I'll leave a more detailed introduction to the next person whom I'm actually supposed to introduce, yeah. He actually needs no introduction, so I don't know why I'm here, but for those of you who do not know him, yeah, Mr. Justice Kamal Bukhari, yeah, is going to chair the session this evening, yeah. He told me to just say, here is Justice Bukhari. So I can't just do that, right? So Justice Bukhari, stellar career in the legal profession, yeah, culminating in the Court of Final Appeal, yeah. I actually Googled Justice Bukhari, yeah, and I hope he won't take me to task for this, yeah. Wikipedia, yeah, says that Justice Bukhari has a record of dissenting judgments, yeah, and because he is the conscience of the court, yeah. So I think that's quite a compliment. And in another line, yeah, it says Justice Bukhari is known for his sense of humor and talkativeness. It's there in the Wikipedia entry, yeah. Well, I'd like to say that in the law faculty, we welcome these two qualities, yeah, sense of humor and talkativeness, especially if you talk the kind of sense that Justice Bukhari does, yeah. I invite now Mr. Justice Bukhari to introduce the speaker for this evening.
Michael, I never asked you to say, here's Justice Bukhari. I told you, say, here's Kemi. I need a sense of humor because yesterday I was grossly insulted by Pooja when she said that she overcame her father's reluctance to see her pursue a career in the law by pointing out that I had done so, and that convinced him that if I could do it, anybody could as well. Nevertheless, I haven't learned from that, and I've come back here, but of course there's much to attract me back here because it's a great privilege to introduce the justice. There was a lot of her background that I had intended to give, but I found that it was all pinned up in the lift, so I can't say that. I had contracted it to something briefer, but I see that it's put up there as well, so I can't say that. Reverting back to the proposition that if I can do it, anybody can, I have to admit there's substance in that because throughout my life I've been very lucky. Other people do not have the same luck, and they rely on higher attainments and higher qualities. And any examination of Justice Hunt's curriculum vitae will show that she possesses those qualities in great measure. We have traveled a short distance to listen to her. She has traveled a great distance to come here. But she will give you a talk which will convince you that it would be worth your while to travel not only as far as she has traveled, but even twice that distance. The art of judging. Now, one likes the facts to be pure and simple, and sometimes they are. One likes the law to be clear, and sometimes it is. But very often, it is neither of them are any of those things. Litigation ensues, and then It falls down to the whole machinery of the law, and ultimately, I think, to the judge. The judge's business to see that justice is done in the instant case, to make her or his reasons intelligible, this being of particular importance when great issues of public law are involved, and to build one more brick into the temple, which is the common law. These are difficult tasks, and it is not given to all of us to come even close to achieving this. But you will hear from the justice, speaking with vast experience, on how one goes about doing these things. There's more that I could say on these things, which are actually close to my heart, and there's more that I could say about justice, my research having reassured me of her great worth. But nothing justifies my further delaying your hearing from her. So I joined you in welcoming her and looking forward to the great day.
Well, thank you very much for that very generous introduction, and I must say that I have been looking forward to meeting this gentleman, particularly when I realized that after he partly retired, as I understand it, only a few years ago, that since that time he's written 4 books. And he may be talkative, but he obviously has a lot to say, and I'm actually dying to read a couple of them that have crocodile and law in the same title. I want to also thank Pooja and the staff at the Center for Comparative and Public Law, who have seamlessly organized my visit. And I also want to acknowledge my old friend Richard Cullen, who I hadn't seen for almost 30 years, but who was very responsible for my being able to come here today. And also, I want to say this is my first visit to Hong Kong, and my husband and I have very much enjoyed the last few days in what is really a fascinating place, historically, geographically, politically, culturally. And we were very happy that the sun came out this afternoon for about 5 minutes, and then we thought it was nice here, but then we saw how immensely gorgeous it was. So it's really a pleasure to offer you a few reflections on the 23 odd years that I spent as a judge in Canada in the province of Alberta. I find that most people, even in the legal profession, don't really know very much about the judicial life, and that's not really surprising because judges do their work necessarily largely behind closed doors. So what I want to do tonight is to try and lift the blind up a little bit and give you an opportunity to peer into what was something of my life as a judge. I'm going to talk in 3 separate parts. I'm going to begin with a very brief look at my life before I became a judge and some of my initial impressions about judicial life. And then I'm going to talk about the very first case that I heard as an appeal court judge, a case called Vreend versus the government of the province of Alberta. And then I'm going to finish with an overview of some of the things that that case taught me about being a judge. So my early beginnings, I never expected to become a judge. In fact, that part of my career, like pretty much the whole rest of my career was a complete accident, unplanned. I started law school in the late 1960s, which when I had a very vague idea that the law could be the best instrument for helping society achieve the changes that, as a young person, I was convinced were necessary. And it was a very turbulent time, particularly in North America. There were race riots in the United States. The Vietnam War was going on. There were concerns, believe it or not, developing about the environment. And at that time, there were very few women who studied law and virtually no women who were law professors. So somebody like myself had no role models to follow. Now, at first, I hated studying law. And I don't know, I'm assuming some of you may be law students. At the beginning, I just found law was terribly monotonous and inaccessible, and I constantly fell asleep in the law library. And I had studied French and sociology, but compared to that, I found the atmosphere in the law school very stifling, and I didn't find my professors particularly accessible, and they didn't seem to be very interested in helping us see pathways to our careers. But by the time I graduated 3 years later, I had completely fallen in love with law, and I still am, quite frankly, in love with law as a discipline. And for that, I'm very grateful and, like you, lucky, very lucky. But at the same time, at that time, I didn't feel the profession was very welcoming to women. And so instead of following any kind of conventional career path, I went to work in a storefront legal aid law office. And part of our work involved doing criminal defense work in three very isolated Aboriginal villages in the northern part of the province where I lived. And although I had grown up in a part of that province that was surrounded by many, many Indian reserves, I had never before in my life met an Aboriginal person. There was really a great divide at that time. And so when I got a chance to work in the northern part of the province, I was just astonished and appalled by the social and economic conditions that I saw there, and how the local people were often treated by the police. Well, hoping somehow that circumstances were better in Canada's far, far north in the Arctic, I accepted a job working for a national Inuit organization, a group of Aboriginal people who at that time were sometimes called Eskimos. And that was a very exciting time in Canada because the Supreme Court had just handed down a major decision for the first time recognizing the possibility of Aboriginal land rights. And the Canadian government began to fund Aboriginal organizations to carry out research into their land use practices with a view to eventually negotiating treaties with them in some of the more isolated parts of the country, and that's what I found myself in. And in fact, the people that I worked for, the Inuit of Canada, in their case, it was going to take another 20 years until an agreement was signed, and then many years longer until that agreement was really being implemented, even today. Well, the years went by, and I eventually became dean of the law school at the University of Calgary, and there for the first time I began to meet real, live judges. And the Chief Justice of the Superior Court encouraged me to apply for a position as a judge, and I eventually agreed, although I must say I thoroughly doubted that anybody would be interested in appointing me. I was a relatively young woman. I had a very unconventional background, and I didn't really expect that anybody would be interested in appointing me to the bench. But to my surprise, I was offered a position and I accepted it. And then I spent many sleepless nights wondering if I'd made a horrible mistake leaving a very stimulating academic career for a life about which I knew virtually nothing. And as an academic, quite frankly, I had considered it part of my responsibilities to criticize judges. But it didn't take me very long to realize that, in fact, I knew absolutely nothing about the life into which I had now entered. And I was very surprised by many things about judicial life, and I was instantly surprised by a number of things. The first thing was that, at least where I worked, being a judge was a very collegial kind of an activity. And at that time, this was in the early 90s, in Canada, most judges were appointed from the practicing bar and from the barrister's side of the profession. And I, of course, had this background in Aboriginal law and environmental law. I had been a professor, and I expected that my new colleagues might eye me with some suspicion. But in fact, the absolute opposite was the case. The minute I walked through the door, they welcomed me with open arms and accepted me and freely offered me assistance as I began to adjust to this new responsibility. And they often had wonderful insights, which I appreciated. I remember in those early days having a very heart-rending custody dispute where both of the parents were very capable and very committed to their children, and I really, in the middle of the case, had absolutely no idea how I should decide it. And one of my colleagues suggested that I should wait till I had heard all the evidence and then go home and sleep on it. And he told me that very often the best answer doesn't become apparent until the very end. And he was quite right in that case. That's exactly what I did, and I did find the best answer that I was capable of finding. Another revelation that I had was the realization that judges don't instantaneously know everything. And when I say that, I think about that now. I think, how could I ever have thought that judges did know everything? But I did really have that rather strange idea, even as an academic who spent all this time criticizing judges. One of my colleagues said to me, well, if you get into the courtroom someday and, you know, you're in a situation you don't know how to handle it, don't hesitate to ask the lawyers. This is why they're there. They're there to help you as a judge. And of course, there were many, many things I didn't know, and I never did hesitate to ask the lawyers on a case for guidance. And they never let me down. And I was never reluctant to ask questions when I didn't understand something or didn't know the answer. Well, I think any job that you take on takes you outside of your comfort zone, but when you become a judge, that is particularly scary because your responsibilities are so enormous. And it took me some time until I became more comfortable with my new role, whether it was the protocol of how should a lawyer address me if I happened to meet them at the grocery store on a Saturday morning, or how to handle a conversation with a lawyer I might run into whose case I had recently dismissed. And I found that most lawyers were quite sensitive to these problems or these realities, but still I had experiences in those early days where a former student would criticize one of my colleagues, or a lawyer whose position on an evidentiary matter I had rejected would offer me an opinion at a social event about why my evidentiary ruling was mistaken. I found some of those experiences quite uncomfortable at the beginning, and for a while it made me very reluctant to go to social occasions with lawyers. But one of my colleagues reminded me that if you're a judge and you go to social occasions, show up late and leave early. And that's what I did. I also had an early experience, a very important one, that underscored to me the importance of judicial independence. And we talk a lot about judicial independence, but this is something that you maybe don't really understand until you do become a judge. I had a case where I convicted a man of domestic abuse of his wife. And apparently afterwards, he told his lawyer that his family members had seen me in private conversation with the complainant, with his wife. And the lawyers, quite appropriately, both the prosecutor and this man's lawyer, asked to come and see me in my office to ask me about this allegation. And I think they were quite embarrassed to do so. But at the same time, they knew that they had to, because in order to protect the integrity of the system. And that encounter really struck home to me how visible judges can be and how important it was to be very careful about interactions with people, particularly in the middle of a trial. And that is part of the reality that one adjusts to when one becomes a judge. And part of the reason why I think the judiciary inevitably has to become somewhat removed from other people. And incidentally, I told them that it wasn't true, and that was the end of the matter, and we moved on. Well, after I'd been on the trial court about 3 years, I was appointed to the Court of Appeal, which was the highest court in the province of Alberta. And the only stop after that in the Canadian system is the Supreme Court of Canada, and normally that is only with leave of the court. So the vast majority of our decisions were the end of the line for the litigants. And almost immediately, my chief judge asked me to sit on this case called Vreend. This was a very high-profile case in Alberta, although I didn't realize that at the time, because the trial had been held in another city other than the one where I lived. And at that time, I couldn't possibly have known what I know today, and that is that that particular case turned out probably to be the most important case that I was going to have in my entire judicial career, even though I eventually heard hundreds and hundreds of cases. Well, let me give you a little bit of the background to this case. Delwyn Vreend was a young lab instructor who was hired by a private religious college. And about 2 years into his employment, when the president of the college asked him about his sexual orientation, he admitted that he was a homosexual. About a year later, he was terminated by the college because of his non-compliance with the college's policy against homosexual practices. And there were no concerns about his competence. In fact, he had very, very good job appraisals. His complaint to the Alberta Human Rights Commission was rejected because at that time, the relevant law in our province called the Individual Rights Protection Act did not list sexual orientation as a protected ground against discrimination. And having had his complaint dismissed, he then sought a declaration in the Superior Court of Alberta to the effect that this law breached Section 15 of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms, which guarantees equality to all Canadians. Now, I'm just going to digress here for a moment to explain for those of you who don't know that Canada is a federal state, so the provincial governments as well as the national government have legislative powers independent of one another. The Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms was enacted in 1982, and it constitutionalized certain rights for Canadian citizens, including the right to be treated equally before the law on certain specified grounds, which included such matters as race, gender, and religion. Now, the Charter gave the power to judges to scrutinize both federal and provincial laws to make sure that they complied with the Charter, along with the power to strike down laws that didn't comply. And this was nothing short of a revolutionary development in Canadian law, because it fundamentally altered the role that judges had. And I must say that by the time I became a judge, which was about 10 years after the Charter came into effect, many, many judges still were struggling with their new responsibilities, and quite a few of them were still not very keen about the idea of telling legislators that their laws didn't comply with the Charter. Well, when Delwyn Breen's case went forward, the trial judge, a woman named Justice Russell, granted the declaration that he sought. And by way of remedy, she read the phrase sexual orientation into the Individual Rights Protection Act, effectively making discrimination based on sexual orientation a new ground, a new right under the provincial law. The appeal court panel on which I sat when when the government of Alberta appealed her decision, the panel included two very experienced men, Justices McClung and O'Leary, and I'm going to return a little bit later to that point, the point that they were very experienced. Obviously, I wasn't, and certainly not as an appeal court judge. They each wrote an opinion allowing the appeal of the government of Alberta, and I wrote a dissent. And my colleague, Justice O'Leary, wrote a very scholarly opinion, as he typically did, concluding that this legislation did not create a distinction based on sexual orientation, and that the legislator's silence or refusal to protect against sexual orientation did not constitute discrimination. My other colleague, Justice McClung, wrote a decision that was very, very colorful in language, and this was typical of the way he wrote. And I'm going to quote a few passages from his decision so that you'll see what I mean. He concluded that the legislation gave the same protection to heterosexuals and to homosexuals. He said that the legislation, quote, leaves heterosexuals the choice of contracting with or employing homosexuals. Similarly, homosexuals may employ, contract, or deal with homosexuals as they might choose. End of quote. He thought that legislation that was silent about sexual orientation was not a law that would attract scrutiny under the Charter. And he said that he was unable to conclude, quote, that it was a forbidden, let alone reversible, legislative response for the province of Alberta to step back from the validation of homosexual relations, including sodomy, as a protected and fundamental right, thereby rebutting a millennia of moral teaching, end of quote. He derided, quote, rights restless judges who pitchfork their courts into the uncertain waters of political debate, end of quote. And he cautioned that judicial independence would suffer if judges continued to push the constitutional envelope, adding that an overridden public would demand and earn the right for direct input into the selection of judges. So he saw many dangers in the idea of judges, in effect, rewriting laws for the legislature when legislators had made a deliberate choice not to do that. Now, before I talk a little bit about my dissent and then about the Supreme Court decision that resulted, let me just say a few words about the history of human rights in the province of Alberta and the pre-vreened context of sexual orientation issues at that time. There are many, many examples to illustrate that discrimination against minorities and against women was very deeply rooted in Alberta's social attitudes and state policy. And just to give you a couple of examples, the Hutterites, who were a Christian sect who farmed communally, were the target of legislation in the 1940s that restricted their ability to purchase land and required that they get permission from a board before they purchased more land. There was a trial decision in the 1960s that upheld the refusal of a hotel to rent a room to a black person, despite the fact that there was legislation prohibiting innkeepers from refusing to serve travelers. And 1928 legislation permitted the government to order forced sterilization of men and women who were considered to have mental health issues. That law, by the way, resulted in something like 2,800 such individuals being the victims of such sterilization between 1928 and 1972. And eventually in 1996, as a result of litigation by one of the victims of this policy, a very brave woman named Leanne Muir, eventually the government of Alberta was forced or agreed to negotiate with some 750 of these victims and provided compensation to them in the amount of about $131 million Canadian dollars. In any event, many of these forms of discrimination came to an end in the early 1970s when a new government was elected and it passed laws such as the Individual Rights Protection Act and it established a Human Rights Commission. But nevertheless, the issue of sexual orientation remained extremely contentious in Alberta. The government, for example, rejected recommendations from the Human Rights Commission that they should amend the law and add sexual orientation as a prohibited ground of discrimination. A cabinet minister in the late 1980s declared that the province would never ban discrimination based on sexual orientation if it meant that homosexuals could teach in schools. And another minister of the Crown declared that, quote, two homosexuals do not constitute a family. And there was evidence in the Vriend case to show that there had been many proposals to amend the Human Rights Act to include sexual orientation, but in all cases the government had rejected the recommendations. So it was very apparent that the government had made a deliberate policy choice not to protect from discrimination based on sexual orientation. Well, when the Vriend case was argued in the Court of Appeal in the mid-1990s, Section 15 law under the Charter about equality rights was still really at its infancy. And in one of the early cases, one of the very early cases about Section 15, the Supreme Court had described the guarantee of equality under the Charter as a concept, an elusive concept that lacked precision. And this commentary by the court in the earlier case gave me some pause while we were deliberating over this case, because I have to admit that I too found it a very elusive concept that lacked precision. I'm not going to linger a long time on my dissent in the case, because of course it was the Supreme Court decision that ultimately was important. But I rejected the arguments that the government of Alberta made, that our case concerned private action rather than government action. And the significance of that was that it's only government action that is subject to charter review, not private action. And it seemed very, very obvious to me. In fact, quite honestly, I could hardly believe that they made that argument, because what Mr. Vreen was contesting was not, at that point, the fact that he had been fired by the college, but what he was contesting was the fact that the provincial law did not protect from discrimination based on sexual orientation. I took the view that the key issue in our case had never been faced by the Supreme Court, which was whether legislative silence could constitute the drawing of a distinction for the purposes of Section 15, the equality guarantee. And I decided that it could, depending on the context of the case and the purpose of the failure of the legislature to act. I rejected the argument of the government that there was no distinction drawn in this case between homosexuals and heterosexuals, as they argued, because they said homosexuals had exactly the same rights under the Act as heterosexuals. But it seemed to me that the facial neutrality of this legislation was simply illusory. And I took account of the argument that the government pressed, that the courts should defer to the legislative choice that had been made. But I concluded that the courts had an obligation to assess whether there was a charter breach, whether, even in the face of a very difficult case like a Section 15 case. And I held, like the trial judge had done, that the government's failure to protect from discrimination based on sexual orientation was a breach of the Charter, and I declared the law of to be invalid for a period of 1 year on this ground, giving the legislature time to decide how to make its amendments. Well, there was a huge flurry of media attention following this decision. And some of the most vitriolic commentary came from a magazine called the Alberta Report, which was a very conservative publication with very strong anti-gay sentiments. It published an article that said, quote, "For over a decade, homosexuals, feminists, criminals, and a plethora of other cause pleaders have held sway in the courts using the Charter of Rights and Freedoms to advance a stridently liberal agenda," end of quote. It noted that this tide of unwelcome judicial activism might have been halted by veteran judges McClung and O'Leary, who between them had a total, had more than 70 years of legal experience. And they described Justice McClung as being very respected, and they said that Justice O'Leary had equally impeccable credentials, underscoring that he had attended the Harvard Law School. Now, in contrast, it pointed out, and this was true, that much of my career had been in academia, but they made no mention of my master's degree from the Harvard Law School. And they wrongly described Justice Russell as also having been a former academic, totally ignoring her very distinguished career as a government lawyer in the province of Alberta. And it seemed to me, when I read that one article, that the message was very clear. That message being that two women who supposedly had been academics were in favor of gay rights, while two very experienced male judges were not. The article went on to describe me and Justice Russell as, quote, charter yuppies and clones or wannabes of the activist wing of the Supreme Court of Canada. And in contrast, it said that Justice McClung had a common sense Alberta perspective. The case went to the Supreme Court. Mr. Vriend appealed. And by the time it got there, there was a raft of interveners, more than 17 of them, who took varied positions on the case, both for the appeal and against. And those who supported Mr. Vriend had the advantage of a series of Supreme Court cases on Section 15, which came out after our decision. And those more recent decisions had really put a lot of meat on the bones of Section 15. The Supreme Court's decision to allow Mr. Breen's appeal was nearly unanimous. It was very long, some 200 paragraphs. And the Supreme Court thought that the main issue was whether the Alberta government's decision not to include sexual orientation breached Section 15. It rejected the government's argument that legislative omission was not subject to charter scrutiny, noting that passing the act itself was a legislative act. It concluded that under-inclusiveness within the legislation should not insulate the law, since otherwise form would govern over substance. The court rejected Justice McClung's very narrow view about the role of the courts, pointing out that it was the Constitution and not the courts themselves that limits what legislators do. The Supreme Court described as, and I must say I even now like this turn of phrase, thin and impoverished the notion that the Alberta government put forward about equality. The court noted that although this legislation offered formal equality between homosexuals and heterosexuals, it denied substantive equality to homosexuals, and if nothing else, said the court, it gave rise to a discriminatory effect because homosexuals were denied the protection of the human rights law. The court, when it came to the issue of remedy, which I must say was something I struggled a great deal with myself, the court adopted the same approach to remedy as Justice Russell had and as I had not. And the court determined that the appropriate remedy was to read the word sexual orientation into the law. In coming to that conclusion, the court emphasized some information that really, at least I don't recall it having gotten any attention when the case was argued in the Court of Appeal. And this was the fact that after the trial decision, when members of the government were asked whether they would now amend the act, the response was that they were leaving the issue of sexual orientation to the courts. And so the Supreme Court was able to take that as being effectively an invitation for it to craft the remedy it thought appropriate, and reading sexual orientation into the law, said the court, was consistent with the legislative intent. It's not for me, of course, to assess the long-term impact of this decision, but I can tell you that in the now some 20, if my math is right, odd years since that decision came out, sexual orientation within our country is prohibited every which way. And there really has been a complete sea change in the attitude to sexual orientation. But rather than talking about the impact of the case since then, I just want to say a couple of things about what happened afterwards. And I also say that some of the things that happened afterwards, as I'll say in a moment when I finish my comments, I wasn't even aware of at the time. But in researching matters since I retired, I discovered that there had been calls upon the Alberta legislature to invoke the notwithstanding clause. The notwithstanding clause was part of the charter that effectively permits legislators to bypass the charter. But this the government refused to do. And the Human Rights Commission thereafter took complaints about discrimination based on sexual orientation. But it took our government more than a decade to actually amend the law. Of course, in practice, the law had been amended by the Supreme Court decision, but the legislators nevertheless wouldn't actually touch the question for some 10 years afterwards. Well, let me finish by offering a few observations about how this case impacted what became my understanding of the role of an appellate court judge. One of the first things that I learned was how much work is involved in being an appellate judge. When I went back so many years later and reread the three decisions, I was reminded of how intellectually grueling the exercise had been. And I can tell you that being an appellate judge, being any judge, but being an appellate judge is just plain hard work, and the work never seems to end, and it has no shortcuts if you want to do a good job. Second, for me, the case really underscored the importance of judicial independence again. My technique for protecting myself as a judge was to really ignore the controversy that swirled around any high-profile cases in which I was involved. I remember at that time I had an assistant who, for whatever reason, thought I would be interested in seeing the press reports surrounding the Breen case. So every day I would come into my office and find this little pile of newspaper clippings on my desk that she had cut out of the paper, so I could see what people were saying about the decision. And I finally said to her, look, thank you very much, but no, thank you, I don't. I'm not interested. And so I ignored what anybody said, quite frankly. And this, of course, isn't the only way that a judge can ensure his or her independence, but It worked for me. But having said that, I found it very, very fascinating within the last year or so to go back and look at the things that happened in Alberta after the litigation was over. But still, I'm glad that I didn't follow those events at the time, because I couldn't have done anything. I had made the best decision I knew how. I had nothing more to say on the topic. And if I had plunged myself into the after effects of the case, I would have accomplished absolutely nothing. And the reality is that judges have very heavy workloads, and they just don't have a lot of time to dwell on decisions that they've already made. Third, I learned a lot about the dynamics of being on an appeal court and why, even though you might take issue with your colleagues or one of your colleagues about a case, your collegiality requires you to sign your judgment and move on. I disagreed with, in particular, Justice McClung's views, and in particular, how he expressed them in that case. But nevertheless, and he obviously disagreed with me too, we worked together for many, many years in an atmosphere which I believe was one of mutual respect. The fact that we took diametrically different views on a case did not in any way undermine our ongoing relationship. Fourthly, the case taught me a lot about writing appellate decisions. And in an appellate decision, in my view, virtually every word has to be crafted with care. Why? Because lawyers inevitably try to use your words in ways that you never, ever intended. And I found that as the years went by and the longer I was a judge, I became more and more narrow in my approach, simply because of that reality. Now, that's not the only way to carry out judicial decision making. I mentioned earlier about the need for new judges to find their comfort zone. And the same thing applies to judgment writing. There are those who are able to write decisions the way Lord Denning did. And there are others, like myself, who completely lack that skill. And of course, many types of judicial writing can contribute effectively to the development of the law, so long as the decisions are clear. Fifthly, I learned a lot about the role of an intermediate appellate court. Sometimes it can be very discouraging to work very, very hard on a complex and technically difficult case when you know it's very likely that a higher court is going to have the last word. But the Breen case taught me that really all judges can learn from one another when others have applied their thinking caps to a very difficult legal problem. And in my view, more minds deliberating over the same difficult issues lead to a better outcome at the end of the day. I also learned that as a judge, one must be true to oneself. Someone commented early on after the case that I had been very courageous to dissent on my very first appeal case. And I replied that it wasn't a question of bravery, more likely it was a question of ignorance, because it had simply never occurred to me not to dissent. I felt intuitively that this man had been treated unfairly. And of course, that can be said about many situations, and the law doesn't always offer a remedy. But in that particular case, I felt that it could, and I felt that it must, and in the end, it did. Someone else once asked me if my gender had influenced my decision in that case, and I really had no answer to that question. Undoubtedly, a judge's life experiences affect the lens through which they see a case. As a young lawyer in particular, I had for sure experienced both subtle and not so subtle gender discrimination, and I did understand what it's like to be part of the other group when you're assessed by stereotypes about that group rather than your individual qualities. And you might ask whether that made me more sensitive to his circumstances. Maybe it did, but maybe it didn't, because what I learned was that many of my male colleagues were at least as sensitive and as open-minded about differences as I ever could have hoped to be. In fact, I had a conversation with an older male colleague very early in my judicial career, and that conversation taught me pretty well everything that I needed to know about differences. I had only been a trial judge a short time when the Canadian Bar Association released a report from its task force on gender equality in the legal profession. This was a wide-ranging examination of what the profession needed to do to promote gender equality. And among other things, the report recommended that there should be mandatory education for judges on racial and gender issues. This report was heavily criticized in the judicial dining room where I lunched most days. And at the time, I was only one of a handful of women judges on the trial court. And though I admired many of the ideas in the report, for probably the very first time in my life, I found myself reluctant to say anything in the face of my colleagues' views. But one day I shared these feelings with another colleague in a group of judges who were studying French together. And this colleague said to me that I should never feel silenced now that I was a judge. He pointed out that many people in our society have to be very careful about what they say, but not judges, he insisted. He said that our freedom to say what we think is the most precious thing that a judge can have. And that very brief conversation with that colleague informed absolutely everything that I did for the rest of my career on the bench. Being a judge is really challenging, but it's also really stimulating to go to work every day to learn new things, and in the company of smart, creative people to struggle to solve difficult legal and social problems. I feel immensely privileged to have spent more than two decades of my life doing that. And I also feel very privileged to have had the chance to share these insights with you today. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the justice has spoken with gentle but persistent authority, and she has given you full and indeed ample evidence of the legal learning that makes for a very good judge. And yet she is more than that. Why is that so? Well, she told you right at the beginning. She loves the law. So the opportunity before you now is to ask questions and receive answers full of learning, valuable, and given with every effort to make the answer as helpful to you as possible. You now have this opportunity. Now, I've been asked to invite you to wait for the microphone, even if your voice is a very carrying one, simply because even though we can all hear you without amplification, the recording devices may not be able to do quite so well. Thank you very much. Yes, there's a question there.
I'd just like to ask, I'm very curious. You said you experienced subtle and not so subtle discrimination. What are these discriminations, the subtle ones and the not so subtle? Thank you.
One of the first things that I noticed, I mean, I could go on this topic for a long time, but I'll limit myself. I remember as a law student, very small minority of women in the class, I remember one of my classmates, a guy, at one point saying to me, "Well, I just can't figure out what you women are after in law school." And I thought to myself, well, that's a very weird comment. Like, what's anybody after in law school? One of the most difficult experiences I had as a law student was when it came time to, I don't know if you have the system here, we had a system where you had to go an article with a lawyer for a year before you could take the bar exams and be called to the bar. And I was a top student in my class. And I did, there at that time there was no system really for finding jobs. You were on your own, you just went out and did what you could. But I remember quite early on having a male colleague in my class who was a much worse student than I was, who got an articling job with one of the biggest law firms in the city where I went to law school. And I found that very difficult to cope with because I never could figure out whether I didn't get such job offers because of my gender or whether there was something wrong with me that prevented me from, you know, breaking into this world. And to be quite honest, I think now, with the benefit of these decades of experience, that there was absolutely nothing wrong with me. There was something wrong with them, you know. But at the time, I didn't know that. Those are just examples of what I might call the subtle, I don't know if that's subtle or not subtle. The other things that happened to me later on were when I was working for the Inuit, as you know, I was a very young lawyer, of course, and I can remember being in negotiating sessions with, typically I would be the only woman there, and with government people, and I remember there was one older man who kept calling me dear all the time, and I finally said to him, "Stop calling me that. I'm not your dear." And I think that, you know, the poor guy was just so taken aback. Okay, you're not my dear. Or later on when I was an academic and I got involved working in natural resources law, again, this was an area at that time that there were no women in this field. And I was on the board of directors of an organization called the Petroleum Lawyers Association, and they had never had a woman before, and when the notices of the meetings came out, the man who was the chairman always, the letter began, "Gentlemen." And these may sound, I don't know, do they sound like petty things to you? They were indicative of an atmosphere. And I have to say that I think some things have changed, but regretfully, not all things have changed. And I have many former students, young women who are still struggling very hard to cope with family life and career choices. And I myself didn't have that to deal with because I never had children. But anyway, I hope that that answers your question.
Who's next?
Good evening. Do you think there are any particular personality traits that renders a person unsuitable to be a judicial officer?
Well, personality traits, I don't know, but I would say in terms of personal qualities, if I could put it that way. Well, let me put it in a more positive way. Okay, and you can figure out the negative. I think that I think the utterly most important part of a good judicial mentality is open-mindedness. And I can scarcely emphasize that more. And of course, the other thing that I think is immensely important, and it's a quality that quite frankly can become more difficult over time, is patience. Because, of course, to exercise your open-mindedness, you have to patiently listen. And I say it can become more difficult over time. I don't mind saying that as the years went by, I think I maybe had eventually a tendency to become a little jaded at times. I hope I controlled it in myself, but I'm talking about my inner feelings, not hopefully how I express them. But you can begin to think you've heard it all before, you've heard the lawyers make that kind of silly argument before. I mean, that for me, anyway, was almost inevitable with the years of experience. But to get back to the open-mindedness, the fact is that you can never tell what might come out of a case. And I would say that the overwhelming majority of the judges that I worked with, even if they didn't begin by being open-minded, they became more and more open-minded with the passage of time, because you come to realize that there are a vast array of choices out there, and you must keep your mind absolutely open up until the end of the case.
Well, that's excellent. Two questions, both of them consisting of nothing but questions. No speech, no preambles. Which is the third question?
Thank you, Madam Justice. I was just wondering, because when you look at the Supreme Court of the United States, sometimes people will say that there is a predictability. You can see that certain judges will decide in such a way. I wonder whether in the Canadian experience within the judiciary, whether there are such perceptions or those kinds of discussions among judges. And a further question to that will be, in terms of deciding the makeup of the, who sits in that case in the Court of Appeal, whether those kind of impression will factor into the consideration of the chief judge in terms of arranging the court's makeup. Thank you.
Okay, well, I'm going to start with the second question first. Certainly, the Supreme Court of Canada most typically decides cases with a full bench of nine people, occasionally with seven, but it's rare. So as far as the Supreme Court is concerned, that means that everybody's on the cases. An intermediate appellate court, such as the one that I was on, there was, I would say, generally speaking, there might have been a few exceptions, but generally speaking, there was no, stacking the deck on cases by the Chief Justice. Ultimately, of course, the Chief Justice is responsible for assigning cases. But the way we did our work was such that there would be a list of cases for an entire week, and there would be a panel of judges assigned to hear that list of cases, and whatever you got on your list was whatever you got on your list. And so there was occasionally a case on our court. We mostly sat three judges. Occasionally on, there were a few cases over the time that I was on the court where there were five judges, and those would be special assignments by the Chief Justice. But in my experience, certainly our Chief Justice was very even-handed, and there was no stacking the court to get a particular outcome. Now, your first question, which I find very fascinating, about the American Supreme Court. Well, I have to be a bit careful here because, of course, I'm Canadian, and we Canadians sometimes might think that there are things about our system that are better than things about their system. The Canadian Supreme Court, I do not think that one could really say that there is very much predictability at all about how certain judges might decide cases. People might tend to think that there's a particular judge who, for example, is more pro-defense in a criminal case, or somebody that's more pro the prosecution in criminal cases. That might crop up from time to time. You might think that there are some judges on the Supreme Court that are more liberal in their approach to the charter, for example, and others that are less so. But by and large, I don't think that our Supreme Court is really predictable at all. Now, the American Supreme Court. I was at a conference a few years ago where an American writer who's a specialist on the Supreme Court, I forget his name, he's written two or three books about the American Supreme Court. And he gave a speech in which he talked about this, and he essentially said, yes, well, there's this case coming and that case coming, and of course the decision's going to be this, and in that case the decision's going to become that. And I asked him, I just couldn't help myself, I said, are you kidding me that you can actually predict, because the essential quality of a judge is to be open-minded. So how can it possibly be that a journalist or whoever, anybody, could predict what way your Supreme Court might decide a case? Now, and he insisted that that was so, and that that court, and I don't know, but he insisted that that court had become so politicized that it very much broke down. And I think maybe not on all kinds of cases, from what I understand, but certain types of cases that are very, very high profile. I guess perhaps in their system that is possible, but I still have to believe, and I'm basing this on some of the things that I've read. Their Chief Justice, who I certainly don't know, I don't know anything about him other than what I've read, but I have read that his position on certain issues has become less predictable over time, and to me that accords with what I think is realistic and right about being a judge, that you shouldn't be able to tell how a court's going to decide a case based on their own views, because, of course, as I said in my little talk, we all have personal views about some things, but your role as a judge is to set those views to one side as much as you can. And I remember hearing a member of our Supreme Court, and it might even have been now Chief Justice McLaughlin, who I understand was recently speaking here, and a jurist who is really exceptional. And I think it was her, in fact, who described the business of judging as having to almost mentally go down from the bench and sit on the one side of the argument and imagine what that is like, and then to mentally go and sit on the other side of the argument and imagine what that's like, leaving your own personal predilections behind on the bench. And at the time, I thought that was a very interesting way of describing what I think you should do.
Thank you so much for your candor.
Please identify yourself.
Thank you so much for your candor and sharing. I'm curious to hear more about judicial receptivity towards the need for training, particularly in concepts such as gender, race, and increasingly, I would say, religious sensitivities. I understand that when the idea was first floated, there was a fair bit of resistance or...
When
the idea was first floated,
you
mentioned that it wasn't sort of well received.
Yeah.
Could you share a little bit now about what the judicial training program is like, particularly on these aspects?
Well, I think, and it's not just me saying this, I have heard this said by judges involved in judicial education in other countries. I have heard them say, and I agree with them, that our system of judicial education in Canada is really excellent. We have an organization called the National Judicial Institute. The head of it is a judge who has, for a time, stepped out of judging and works full-time on judicial education programs. The judicial education, each judicial education program is taught by judges, it's organized, it's planned, it's thought through by judges. And the NJI, that's its acronym, for quite some long time now has made it part of each judicial education program that it gives to include what I think they call, as they describe, a social context training. And so I would say that at the beginning there was resistance for sure, but my impression is that there isn't resistance to that anymore in the judiciary. On the contrary, I think the Canadian judiciary by and large is very open to that kind of education. Now, it's not compulsory, it's not mandatory, but all judges are certainly encouraged to participate in education programs regularly, and I would say the vast majority of judges do. Having said that, are judges in Canada perfect in this regard? No. And even very, very recently, I was chagrined to hear a discussion on our national broadcasting radio system about domestic violence. And there were a group of women, I think some of them were judges, but by no means all of them, and they were describing the problems in dealing with domestic violence. And some of them gave some, to my mind, in 2016, utterly shocking descriptions of experiences that people, women, victims of domestic abuse had had in the courtroom. And I was totally taken aback by that. So is everything perfect? It isn't. And there is also, in our system, judges are disciplined by an organization called the National Judicial Council, which is made up of the chief justices and associate chief justices from across the country. And there's a case right now before that court involving comments that were made by a judge in the context of a sexual assault case, comments that he supposedly, I haven't read the transcript, but he supposedly made to the complainant in the course of asking questions of her. So to summarize, we have, I think, a very strong judicial education program in Canada, which by and large has been very successful at sensitizing judges, but this is obviously a task that is never finished.
Pooja, you asked me to take four questions. I've taken four questions.
We have time for one more if anybody wants to ask.
Okay.
Justice Hunt, can I ask this question on the classical debate about whether judges are making law or whether judges are really just interpreting law? We understand that Canadian Constitution has this famous saying that Canadian Constitution is a living tree. And I wonder what's your view on that, like especially the case, the Breen case that you mentioned, that do you see yourself as interpreting law, or do you see yourself as making law at a very critical moment at that time in society? And my other question is there any time that your own value system may conflict with the law? Like sometimes it's quite noticeable, especially on religious issue, that if we know the religious belief of a judge, that it's sort of predictable to know their ruling. And I'm not sure whether to you that may not be on religion, may not be your religious belief, but is there any time that your value system may conflict with the law and how you resolve that?
Well, I'm fascinated that these two questions have come up about religion, and I'm curious to, you know, to hear more about why that that is. There's obviously things going on here that are interesting in that regard. But now when I stop to think about it, I suppose in our country too, there are certainly developing some issues. For example, there was a very big case about whether a Muslim woman who was alleging sexual assault against two of her relatives could testify with her face covered. And that case actually went to the Supreme Court, which did not answer the question yes or no, but gave sort of a system of answers or steps to go through. I have to say that during my time as a judge, I never had the impression that religion played a major role in decisions that judges made. Maybe I just wasn't sensitive to that, but I couldn't say, you know, during those years that I was on the bench, that I noticed that very much. In terms of, do judges interpret laws or do they make laws? I mean, to me, that is not really a terribly useful distinction, and I'm not criticizing you when I say that, but I'm just telling you how I feel about it. Because, of course, when you become a judge, you take an oath of office to apply the law fairly, equally, and so on. And sometimes that involves what you might call interpreting the law, I mean in a technical sense, deciding whether a tax statute means A or it means B. But inevitably, given the nature of law, and the case that I talked about is a fine example of that, inevitably there are cases that come along that are totally novel, and really you couldn't possibly describe what a judge is doing as being anything other than making law. Like in that case, the question about whether the silence of the legislature on a particular point was a government action that was subject to charter scrutiny, that was a completely novel question. And of course, we had to make law, or the Supreme Court in particular. But as I said, in Canada, there is no doubt that the Charter, as I said, changed the role of judges. And there are those who would say that that judges became more activist. And that accusation always troubled me when I was a judge, and I don't agree with it. I didn't agree with it in the Breen case, and I don't agree with it today. Why? For exactly the reason that the Supreme Court gave in Breen, and that was perfectly obvious. It was the governments of the 10 provinces and the federal government in Canada that brought the Charter into effect. Judges did not go out and seek this role for themselves. In fact, as I said, many, many judges didn't want to have that role when the Charter first came in, but it was a responsibility, an obligation that was imposed upon them by the governments of our federal country. And so, having been given that responsibility, judges had to exercise it. And it took them inevitably into some of these questions of social policy, even economic policy, that in our system judges had not been involved in before. The interesting thing is, though, in Canada, and this gets into the living tree question a little bit, that I believe that the Charter, in changing the role of judges as it did, has had a bigger impact on the role of judges, even in cases that don't involve the Charter. And why would that be? Well, I suppose it's because deciding Charter cases forced judges to get into these things and forced judges really to take what is often described as a more contextual approach to decision making. And I think that that more contextual approach to decision making has leached inevitably into other areas of law, certainly into other aspects of constitutional law, but probably more broadly than that. And that is the mystery and the beauty of legal development. Things go in ways that nobody could ever predict. And for those of you who are soon to be embarking on this career, I can promise you that you will see that I'm right about that over the course of your career.
only remains for us to thank Justices Hunt and Bukhari, our two judicial gems, yeah, for a stimulating evening. Yeah.
Thank you.